got in the car and I drove. And I never, ever heard from him. Ever.
Here's Michael McDonald with the broadcast premiere of No Looking Back. Here's It's Over Now from Luther Vandross. Something and we'll be right back with Katrina and the Waves, Huey Lewis and the News, Rick James and Hart.
Hi, this is Rick James, and Friday Night Videos will be right back.
Boy, did I have a dream about you.
Hey, I avoid sugar. I'm not gonna blow that. But sometimes I want bubble gum.
Don't blow it when you blow it. When you watch it out for you. Carefree, sugarless bubble gum means no sugar when you chew. So don't blow it when you blow it.
Friday Night Videos and Carefree have a special offer for you. A free REO Speedwagon album for the first 300 people to call 1-800-LUCKY-TV. Compliments of Carefree.
Join Chevy Chase and his family on National Lampoon's European Vacation. Share the sights, the sounds, and the thrill.
Hey, Dad, look. Bedpan.
Of being in Europe.
Carcari.
With Chevy Chase in National Lampoon's European Vacation, rated PG-13. Now playing at a theater near you.
Why did the chicken McNuggets lover cross the road?
Because McDonald's was on the other side.
Heading for McDonald's, chicken McNuggets, heading for a lot of fun. I follow the leader, I follow the signs, to lighten the chicken,
the walk don't run.
McDonald's found a whole new way to eat chicken, grab the number one nugget and start dipping.
It's a good time for the great taste.
Oh, you just can't pass up the head of the class
of McDonald's.
Hey, kiddo, did you win?
Yeah.
What you drinking?
Coke.
New Coke?
Yeah, Coke.
Didn't you write a letter to the Coca-Cola company demanding they bring back the old taste of Coke?
Yeah.
So why are you drinking new Coke?
It tastes great. I love it.
So why'd you go to all the trouble of writing a letter?
Power.
Coca-Cola, have we got a taste for you?
And now, Katrina and the Waves with the broadcast premiere of Do You Want Crying? Don't move, I'll be right back with our next six marvelous videos. Rick James, Hart, The Jesse Johnson Review, Rick Springfield, Pat Benatar, and Corey Hart.
Dealers have brought you the biggest sales event in their history, but it disappears this weekend, so what are you waiting for? The cows to come home? Where you see this sign, Toyota dealers are out to sell a record number of cars and trucks. Imagine the last-minute deals they're willing to work out. Like this extra value package that loads you up for less and can save you up to $659. Toyota's the number one selling import car and small truck. So what are you waiting for? Your ship to come in?
It's not too often the four of us get together like this, but we're here now for a very important reason.
We're here to ask you to please don't drink and drive. It's much too often that traffic fatalities come across our news desk here at Channel 10.
And more times than not, they are alcohol-related. Don't take a chance. Don't let your friends take a chance.
Call a cab or call a friend. You can make a difference. It's your choice, and we at Channel 10 ask that you make the right choice.
Trudell's putting her all in this routine. And the judges love her.
Gatorade is first aid.
Smith moves ahead in what appears to be a one-man race.
Gatorade is first aid.
Double play ball. Andrews to Wiley to Davis.
When you exercise, you lose potassium, fluids, minerals. Gatorade Thirst Quencher helps put them back fast.
That's why the pros drink it. It's thirst aid.
Gatorade is thirst aid for the deep-down body thirst.
Freeza-Burn strikes again. Freeza-Burn. To help put out Freeza-Burn, more and more people are turning to Baggies Extra Protection Freezer Bags. Baggies fights Freeza-Burn with the strength of plastic and nylon. So with Baggies Extra Protection Freezer Bags, there's a lot better chance of putting out the Freeza-Burn in your freezer. Play it safe. Get Baggies Freezer Bags and help put out Freeza-Burn.
Sunday on Knight Rider, Michael leaps into action and tries to stop a beautiful thief, but is in for a real shock.
Oh, dear.
It's Kit to the Rescue on Knight Rider. Then an NBC movie premiere in the tradition of Mad Max, a world of ruins where man's hunger for survival has no boundaries, only ravagers. Sunday.
Everyone's crazy about Sneagrab, Alpine's preseason ski sale. Save up to 80% on famous name ski wear and equipment now through Saturday at Alpine Ski and Sports, Warwick, East Greenwich, and Westerly.
For more information, please call 464-3361.
Excitement fills the air at the Eagle Snacks Quonset International Air Show. Two full days, Saturday and Sunday, August 17th and 18th. The Quonset State Airport, Route 4 off I-95. Gates open at 9.
The Rhode Island Optometric Association recommends that you have your child's eyes examined yearly. Good vision is one advantage every child needs.
It's the right choice, Channel 10.
Hi, this is Julian Lennon playing VJ tonight on Friday Night Videos. And now here's Rick James with Glow. Here's What About Love, Heart.
Meet
Chris Knight, the Einstein of the 80s.
What are you doing out there?
Floating, sir.
His IQ is higher than most people can count.
Have you ever seen a body like this before in your life?
She happens to be my daughter.
Well, then I guess you have.
When they steal his pet project, he turns getting even into a science.
Roger.
Real genius. Rated PG.
Special sneak preview Saturday night.
I want more bits, more bits, more bits. My kibbles and bits and bits and bits. I want more bits, more bits, more bits. My kibbles and bits and bits and bits.
Kibbles and bits and bits and bits. More crunchy bits, more chewy bits, more different kinds of bits than any leading dry dog food.
Kibbles and bits and bits and bits.
Kibbles and bits and bits and bits. More bits in every bite.
More bits.
If the spirit in the air, the sound that you hear, the spirit that exists in a true
when you work the door for a place like this, you get all kinds. But they all have one thing in common. They drink light beer from Miller. They know light tastes great and light's less filling. And you can't afford to get filled up in a place like this, because this place can get pretty darn wild. But don't get me wrong, we have some pretty strict rules here. Hey, not so fast, buddy. We got a dress code here.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Now, Jesse Johnson's review with I Want My Girl. This is Rick Springfield with State of the Heart. This is Julian Lennon, and I'll be right back with Pat Benatar, Corey Hart, and Freddie Jackson.
This is today's Chevrolet, and this is today's Chevrolet. This Chevrolet is specially modified for the International Race of Champions. This is the new Camaro IROC Z28 built for you. Chevrolet has powered more winners than anyone in American racing history. And that helped us build this Chevrolet. World champions drive this Camaro. But the Camaro IROC Z28 makes you feel like a champion.
Drive today, Chevy. Live today, Chevy. Chevy.
It's fun. Getting to the bottom of one.
It's fun getting to the bottom of one.
White Mountain Cooler.
Cooler.
Keeping it light.
Cooler.
Crisp and refreshing.
It's got the taste that's always right. It's fun getting to the bottom of one.
I've been crazy for you, girl, since we were terrible twos. In our butterfly shrink to fit a 501 blues. Now our bodies grew up different, and I love your ways and means. Cause Levi's all we understood is all in the jeans. It's all in the jeans.
Jack Chester is treating his family to a month at the beach. It's quiet.
Thank you.
Secluded.
Get out of my house!
With pool.
Sit down, relax.
And a breathtaking view.
What do you think of these?
Similar?
I just got them.
Who had them before you?
John Candy.
What? Open this door!
In Summer Rental. Rated PG. Starts Friday, August 9th at a theater near you.
Here's Pat Benatar with Invincible. Don't go away. This is Julian Lennon, and I'll be back with Corey Hart, Freddie Jackson, and Cheap Trick.
Hi, this is Corey Hart, and Friday Night Videos will be right back, so stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. This is from the television show.
It's not too often the four of us get together like this, but we're here now for a very important reason.
We're here to ask you to please don't drink and drive. It's much too often that traffic fatalities come across our news desk here at Channel 10.
And more times than not, they are alcohol-related. Don't take a chance. Don't let your friends take a chance.
Call a cab or call a friend. You can make a difference. It's your choice, and we at Channel 10 ask that you make the right choice.
Yeah.
Mr. Fitch?
Yes?
This is Dr. Lee at City Hospital. There's been an accident. You better come right away.
For thousands of parents, this is not just a bad dream. It's real. And more than half of these accidents are alcohol-related.
Yes?
Dad, will you come and get me? Mark's had too much to drink.
And your kids count on a safe ride home? Parents, offer them one. Kids, accept it.
This week, hosting America's best hour of hot new music on the new Solid Gold, Miss Laura Branigan with her latest single. And her co-host, the ladies' choice, Mr. Ray Parker Jr. So come up front for a sensuous hit from Billy Ocean. And meet private dancer Tina Turner, plus John Cafferty and the Beaver Brown Band, Howard Jones, T.G. Shepherd, and Graham Nash. Rocking your way on the new Solid Gold.
Saturday night at 7 on TV 10.
20 years ago, I almost miscarried, so I was given DES. I called it a wonder drug because we had a wonderful girl. Now she has to know that DES can cause medical problems in the children of women who took it. A few daughters have even developed cancer. She must have a DES exam. Chances are she's okay, but why wonder?
Ask your doctor or the state health department about DES, the wonder drug women should wonder about.
Tuesday at Riptide, Murray's enlisting.
I'm leaving the agency.
So the guys decide to throw him a bon voyage party complete with surprises.
I'm planning to sell you to the Soviet Union.
But when Murray gets kidnapped, the chase is on, and it's up to Nick and Cody to keep him out of hot water.
Not to give you goosebumps.
Tuesday.
Boston Children's Museum, a great place to grow.
It's the right choice, Channel 10. It's the right choice, Channel 10. It's right in every way. News that you turn to on JAR. We're bringing it home to you, no matter how far. Connecticut, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, that's the team. It's the right choice, Channel 10.
Got it all wrong.
Mr. Trumbull's under arrest for a felony.
Have a seat, please.
Sir, could I have your business address, please?
2107 Doral.
Wait, sir. You're right.
This is very embarrassing. I've never been in trouble
Index
in my life.
Index finger, please.
I'll need your belt and your shoes.
Why?
In here.
It was an accident. I didn't mean to start a fire.
If you're guilty of starting a forest fire, even accidentally, you'll pay for it.
WJAR-TV, Providence, now in stereo.
Here's Never Surrender from Corey Hart.
Just an Amazon, you're asking for.
Back with Freddie Jackson and Cheap Trick.
I don't know. What are you going to do?
I don't know.
I'd go to college.
Me yeah. too.
If I had the money.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do?
I don't know. What are you going to do?
You don't want those fries.
What are you going to do, Jack? Eat your way to college?
Really? I'm going to college on the new GI Bill. You serve full-time in the armed forces or part-time in the reserves, and you earn a lot of money for tuition.
The new GI Bill.
Are you using that pickle?
Now for young men and women in the armed forces. It's a great place to start. See your local recruiter.
Hey, did you know about the big sneak preview?
Nobody hit me to that, dude.
Pee-wee Herman in Pee-wee's Big Adventure. Special sneak preview this Wednesday.
What? What?
Special sneak preview Wednesday of Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Where is it? Can you see it? Where is it?
Easy, dude. It's at a theater near you. Check local newspapers. Are you coming?
Yeah.
Rated PG. Sneak preview Wednesday. Regular engagement starts Friday, August 9th.
Hey, I avoid sugar. I'm not going to blow that. But sometimes I want bubble gum.
Don't blow it when you blow it. When you're watching out for you. Carefree, sugarless bubble gum means no. Sugar when you chew, so don't blow it when you blow it. Carefree, sugarless bubble gum.
Carefree means no sugar when you chew.
So don't blow it when you blow it.
Sail away. Come to a place with that faraway taste. Go Hawaiian. Hawaiian punch. Oh, sail away on a tropical day. Go Hawaiian. Hawaiian punch. Oh, Hawaiian.
And now, Rock Me Tonight from Freddie Jackson.
I want you, baby.
Back with Cheap Trick.
Have I lost my cool? I have all the girls hanging out with Larry. Don't I also have the tan, the whistle, the cooler 7-Up?
Well, Larry's got a cooler Sprite.
Yeah, so?
So? Girls know Sprite tastes better than 7-Up. It even beat them in a taste test.
Sprite, huh?
Sure. Only Sprite has a great taste of lime.
You know, he's got something there. I only wish we had more of it here.
The winning taste of Sprite.
Wyatt and Gary were a little unpopular. So they decided to do a little something about it.
She's alive! Alive!
I'm gonna show you guys the time of your life.
It was the biggest mistake they ever made. And the best thing that ever happened to them.
It's purely sexual.
Weird Science, rated PG-13. Now at select theaters. Check newspapers.
You have to rise and shine each morning, spreading joy to the world.
Cheetah table splash, you're happy. Cheetah table splash, you're happy, yeah.
Take a minute to indulge yourself every day with Gina Tay, because you can't be good to others unless you're good to yourself.
Everybody's gonna feel it. You're gonna have everybody feeling wonderful, glorious, feeling wonderful as you feel.
You just don't want to admit it, do you, Shelley?
Come on.
Look, who was the original Pepsi freak in
our group? I know. Coke's been winning taste tests all over the country.
Yeah, know why?
Shelly?
Well, it's what?
It's... Gotta go.
What's your hurry, Shelly? Thanks a lot.
Coca-Cola, have we got a taste for you.
Oh!
Here's Cheap Trick with Tonight It's You.
Carpenter's wood glue.
You can make it.
Make it.
You can fix it.
Fix it.
You can do it right.
Do it right.
With Elmer's, America's can-do glues.
You know how much I love light beer from Miller?
Here we go again.
You can see by my feet, light's great taste can't be beat. It's just thrilling how light's less spilling. By now, you know, light's a hit. Guess it's time for me to split. Look out. Yeah.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
That guy makes a big production out of it.
Charlie Brewster is about to discover there are some very good reasons to be afraid of the dark.
Look, I know it's crazy. I know that, but look, Lieutenant...
What happens if you go into that house alone and he gets you?
Fright Night. If you love being scared, it'll be the night of your life. Rated R. Now at select theaters. Check newspapers for showtimes.
Dip, 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 dips. Dip, 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 granola, dip, dip.
Granola dips from Quaker. All the wholesome goodness of chewy, moist granola dipped into real milk chocolate.
Chocolate and granola, lose my self-control. A granola dips, dips.
Now sold as single bars, too.
Thanks for watching. See you next week. Saying goodnight from New York. This is Julian Lennon for Friday Night Videos.
Of a pizza and a soft drink, you can feed an African child for 1 month. For the price of a family dinner, you can feed an African family for 1 month. For the price of a luncheon for business executives, you can feed an African village for 1 month. It's a small price to pay, so give to the African Famine Relief Campaign at your local American Red Cross chapter.
What has Eddie Murphy, Stevie Wonder, Stevie Wonder, Robin Williams, Mr. T, and more? It's the best of Saturday Night Live. Watch it.
Or I'll kill you.
Of course, there's long connections between Burma and the British Empire. Britain has had involvement in Burma since early in the 19th century. It was annexed by the British Empire in 1852. The whole series of wars and battles to make Burma a province of British India. And of course, the country separated to become a separate Crown colony in 1937 and then move towards independence after the Second World War. Aung San Suu Kyi's father was of course one of the heroes of the struggle for Burmese independence, but died before it was fully achieved. She herself moved back into Burma in 1988 after living in Britain so she could look after her critically ill mother. And here they are. Of the Commons, John Burko.
This hall has hosted many events over the past 900 years. In recent times, only a few international figures, Charles de Gaulle, Nelson Mandela, Pope Benedict XVI, and Barack Obama, have spoken here. Today, Aung San Suu Kyi will become the first figure other than a head of state, the first woman from abroad, and the first citizen of Asia to do so. This is not a break from precedent without a purpose. The courage of our guest is legendary. She has withstood the unimaginable suffering of separation from her family and her people with a dignity, fortitude, and resolve which most of us can barely conceive. Her connections with the United Kingdom, reinforced in Oxford yesterday, are intimate. She has been the symbol of resistance to a regime which, even in an imperfect world, has been exceptional in its barbarity. As the United Nations has documented, and from three trips to Burma's borders, I can myself attest, this is a cabal guilty of rape as a weapon of war, extrajudicial killings, compulsory relocation, forced labour, deployment of child soldiers, use of human minesweepers, incarceration of opponents in unspeakable conditions, destruction of villages, obstruction of aid, and excruciating torture. Burma has become a beautiful but benighted land where fear runs through society like blood flowing through veins. One woman has now defied a dictatorship of such depravity for two decades. That is why Aung San Suu Kyi, a leader and a stateswoman, is with us here in Westminster Hall this afternoon. However, there is room for cautious optimism. The recent election to Parliament of our guest, accompanied by 42 of her colleagues, and the release of many political prisoners are welcome signs of reform. We earnestly hope that further and fundamental reform will ultimately lead to the freedom, democracy, and rule of law which we have so long enjoyed and the people of Burma have too long been denied. There is an Asian saying to the effect that a journey of 1,000 miles must start with a single step. We are proud that one such step will be taken in this Parliament today. Parliamentary colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to welcome the conscience of a country and a heroine for humanity, Aung San Suu Kyi.
Lord Speaker, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Prime Minister, my lords and members of the House of Commons. Thank you for inviting me to speak to you here in this magnificent hall. I'm very conscious of the extraordinary nature of this honor. I understand that there was some debate as to whether I would speak here in this splendid setting or elsewhere within the Palace of Westminster. I welcome that debate and discussion. It is what Parliament is all about. I have just come from Downing Street. It was my first visit there, and yet, for me, it was a familiar scene, not just from television broadcasts, but from my own family history. As some of you may be aware, the best-known photograph of my father, Aung San, taken shortly before his assassination in 1947, was of him standing in Downing Street with Clement Attlee and others, with whom he had been discussing Burma's transition to independence. He was pictured wearing a large British military-issue greatcoat. This had been given to him by Jawaharlal Nehru en route to the UK to protect him against the unaccustomed cold. And I must say, having not left my tropical country for 24 years, there have been the odd moments this week when I have thought of that coat myself. A couple of hours ago, I was photographed in the same place where my father was photographed, together with Prime Minister David Cameron, and it was raining. Very British. My father was a founding member of the Burmese Independence Army in World War II. He took on this responsibility out of a desire to see democracy established in his homeland. It was his view that democracy was the only political system worthy of an independent nation. It is a view, of course, that I have long shared. General Slim, commander of the 14th Army, who led the Allied Burmese campaign, wrote about his first encounter with my father in his memoir, Defeat Unto Victory. The meeting came towards the end of the war, shortly after my father had decided that the Burmese Independence Army should join forces with the Allies. General Slim said to my father, "You've only come to us because we are winning," to which my father replied, "It wouldn't be much good coming to you if you weren't, would it?" Slim saw in my father a practical man with whom he could do business. 6 decades later, I strive to be as practical as my father was. And so I'm here, in part, to ask for practical help, help as a friend and an equal, in support of the reforms which can bring better lives, greater opportunities to the people of Burma who have been for so long deprived of their rights and their place in the world. As I said yesterday in Oxford, my country today stands at the start of a journey towards, I hope, a better future. So many hills remain to be climbed, chasms to be bridged, obstacles to be breached. Our own determination can get us so far. The support of the people of Britain and of peoples around the world can get us so much further. In a speech about change and reform, it is very appropriate to be in Westminster Hall because at the heart of this process must be the establishment of a strong parliamentary institution in my own country. The British Parliament is perhaps the preeminent symbol to oppressed peoples around the world of freedom of speech. I would imagine that some people here, to some extent, take this freedom for granted. For us in Burma, what you take for granted, we have had to struggle for long and hard. So many people in Burma gave up so much, gave up everything, in Burma's ongoing struggle for democracy. And we are only now just beginning to see the fruits of our struggle. Westminster has long set a shining example of realizing the people's desire to be part of their own legislative process. In Burma, our parliament is in its infancy, having been established only in March 2011. As with any new institution, especially an institution which goes against the cultural grain of 49 years of direct military rule, it will take time to find its feet and time to find its voice. Our new legislative processes, which undoubtedly are an improvement on what went before, are not as transparent as they might be. I would like to see us learn from established examples of parliamentary democracies elsewhere so that we might deepen our own democratic standards over time. Perhaps the most critical moment in establishing the credibility of the parliamentary process happens before Parliament even opens, namely, the people's participation in a free, fair, inclusive electoral process. Earlier this year, I myself participated in my first ever election as a candidate. To this day, however, I have not yet had the chance to vote freely in any election. In 1990, I was allowed to cast an advance vote while under house arrest, but I was prevented from contesting as a candidate for my party, the National League for Democracy. I was disqualified on the grounds that I had received help from foreign quarters. This amounted to BBC broadcasts that the authorities considered to be biased in my favor. What struck me most ahead of this year's by-elections was how quickly people in the constituencies around Burma grasped the importance of participating in the political process. They understood firsthand that the right to vote was not something given to all. They understood that they must take advantage when the opportunity arose, because they understood what it meant to have that opportunity taken away from them. During the years that I lived in the United Kingdom, I never had the right to vote myself, but I can remember, even during my university days, that I was always trying to encourage my friends to exercise their right to vote. It was never clear to me whether they followed those instructions, but it was clear to me even then that if we do not regard the rights we have, we run the risk of seeing those rights erode away. To those who feel themselves to be somehow above politics, I want to say that politics should be seen neither as something that exists above us, nor as something that happens beneath us, but something that is integral to our everyday existence. After my marriage, I constantly preached my gospel of political participation to my late husband, Michael. I still distinctly recall the occasion when a canvasser knocked on the door of our Oxford home during an election campaign. Michael opened the door, and when he saw the gentleman poised to deliver his campaigning pitch, he said, "It's no use trying to win me over. It's my wife who decides how I should vote. She's out now. Why don't you come back later?" The canvasser did come back later, mainly, I think, to see what a wife who decided how her husband should vote looked like. It has been less than 100 days since I, together with my fellow National League for Democracy candidates, was out on the campaign trail across Burma. Our by-elections were held on April the 1st, and I'm conscious that there was a certain skepticism that this would be another elaborate April Fool's joke. In fact, it turned out to be an April of new hope. The voting process was largely free and fair, and I would like to pay tribute to President U Thein Sein for this and for his commitment and sincerity in the reform process. As I have long said, it is through dialogue and through cooperation that political differences can best be resolved, and my own commitment to this path remains as strong as ever. Elections in Burma are very different to those in many more established democracies such as yours. Apathy, especially among the young, is certainly not an issue. For me, the most encouraging and rewarding aspect of our own elections was the participation in such vast numbers and with such enthusiasm of our young people. Often, our biggest challenge was restraining the crowds of university students, school children, and flag-waving toddlers who greeted us on the campaign, blocking the roads throughout the length of towns. The day before the elections, on my way to my constituency, I passed a hillock which had been occupied by a group of children, the oldest about 10 or 11, their leader standing at the summit holding the NLD flag. The passion of the electorate was a passion born of hunger for something long denied. Following Burma's independence in 1948, our parliamentary system was, of course, based on that of the United Kingdom. The era became known in Burmese as the parliamentary era, a name which, by the mere necessity of its application, speaks of the unfortunate changes which followed. Our parliamentary era, which lasted more or less until 1962, could not be said to have been perfect. But it was certainly the most progressive and promising period until now in the short history of independent Burma. It was at this time that Burma was considered the nation most likely to succeed in Southeast Asia. Things did not, however, go entirely to plan. They often don't in Burma and indeed in the rest of the world. Now, once again, we have an opportunity to re-establish true democracy in Burma. It is an opportunity for which we have waited many decades. If we do not use this opportunity, if we do not get things right this time around, it may be several decades more before a similar opportunity arises again. And so it is for this reason that I would ask Britain, as one of the oldest parliamentary democracies, to consider what it can do to help build the sound institutions needed to support our nascent parliamentary democracy. The reforms taking place, led by President U Thein Sein, are to be welcomed. But this cannot be a personality-based process. Without strong institutions, this process will not be sustainable. Our legislature has much to learn about the democratization process, and I hope that Britain and other democracies can help by sharing your own experiences with us. Thus far, I've only spent a matter of minutes inside the Burmese parliament when I took the oath as a new MP last month. I must say that I found the atmosphere rather formal. Men are required to wear formal headgear. There is certainly no heckling. I would wish that over time, perhaps, we will reflect the liveliness and relative informality of Westminster. I am not unaware of the saying that more tears have been shed over wishes granted than over wishes denied. Nevertheless, it is when Burma has its own satisfactory equivalent of Prime Minister's questions that we will be able to say that parliamentary democracy has truly come of age. I would also like to emphasize the importance of establishing requisite parliamentary control over the budget. In all this, what is most important is to empower the people, the essential ingredient of democracy. Britain is living proof that a constitution does not need to be written down in order to be effective. It is more important that a constitution should be accepted by the people, that the people should feel it belongs to them, that it is not an external document imposed on them. One of the clearly stated aims of my party, the National League for Democracy, is constitutional reform. Britain's original constitution was drawn up following the meeting between my father, Aung San, and Clement Attlee here in London in 1947. This constitution may not have been perfect, but at its core was a profound understanding of and respect for the aspirations of the people. The current constitution, drawn up by the military government in 2008, must be amended to incorporate the basic rights and aspirations of Burma's ethnic nationalities. In over 60 years of independence, Burma has not yet known a time when we could say that there was peace throughout the land. At this very moment, hostilities continue between Kachin forces and the state armed forces in the north. In the west, communal strife has led to the loss of innocent lives and the displacements of tens of thousands of hapless citizens. Since this speech was drafted, I've also heard that hostilities have resumed in the east of the country between Shan troops and the troops of the government. We need to address the problems that lie at the root of conflict. We need to develop a culture of political settlement through negotiation and to promote the rule of law, that all who live in Burma may enjoy the benefits of both freedom and security. In the immediate term, we also need humanitarian support for the many peoples in the north and west, in the west, largely women and children, who have been forced to flee their homes. As the long history of the United Kingdom shows clearly, people never lose their need to preserve their national or ethnic identity. This is something which goes beyond, which supersedes economic development. And that is why I hope that in working for Burma's national reconciliation, the international community will recognize that it is political dialogue and political settlement which must be given precedence over short-term economic development. If differences remain unresolved, if basic aspirations remain unfulfilled, there cannot be an adequate foundation for sustainable development of any kind, economic, social, or political. Britain has for so long, under successive governments, including the present Conservative Liberal Democratic Coalition and the previous Labour government, been a staunch and unshakable supporter of aid efforts in Burma. I hope you can continue to help our country through targeted and coordinated development assistance. Britain has been, until now, the largest bilateral donor to Burma. It is in education in particular that I hope the British can play a major role. We need short-term results so that our people may see that democratization has a tangible, positive impact on their lives. Vocational training and creation of employment opportunities to help address Burma's chronic youth unemployment are particularly important. Longer term, Burma's education system is desperately weak. Reform is needed, not just of schools and the curriculum and the training of teachers, but also of our attitude to education, which at present is too narrow and rigid. I hope also that British businesses can play a role in supporting the democratic reform process through what I have termed democracy-friendly investment. By this, I mean investment that prioritizes transparency, accountability, workers' rights, and environmental sustainability. Investment, particularly in labor-intensive sectors, when carried out responsibly and with positive intent, can offer real benefits to our people. One test will be whether new players will benefit from the investment coming in. Britain has played an important role in facilitating the forthcoming visit next month of the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative Secretariat. I hope this will be the start of many similar initiatives in the months ahead. It was through learning while at Oxford about two great British leaders, Gladstone and Disraeli, that I first developed my understanding of parliamentary democracy. I learned the basics, that one accepts the decision of the voters, that the governing power is gained and relinquished in accordance with the desires of the electorate. That is the system which goes on, and that ultimately everyone gets another chance. These are things taken for granted here in Britain. But in 1990 in Burma, the winner of the elections, the NLD, was never allowed even to convene parliament. I hope that we can leave such days behind us, and that as we look forward to the future, it will be the will of the people that is reflected faithfully in Burma's changing political landscape. This journey out of Burma has not been a sentimental pilgrimage to the past, but an exploration of the new opportunities at hand for the people of Burma. I have been struck throughout my trip by how extraordinarily warm-hearted and open the world has been to us. To experience this firsthand after so long physically separated from this world has been very moving. Countries that geographically are distant have shown that they are close to Burma in what really matters. They are close to the aspirations of the people of Burma. We are brought into proximity through our shared values, and no geographical distance, no human-made barriers can stand in our way. During the years of my house arrest, it was not just the BBC and other broadcasting stations that kept me in touch with the world outside. It was the music of Mozart and Ravi Shankar and the biographies of men and women of different races and religions that convinced me I would never be alone in my struggle. The prizes and honors I received were not so much a personal tribute as a recognition of the basic humanity that unites one isolated person to the rest of the world. During our dark days in the 1990s, a friend sent me a poem by Arthur Hugh Clough. It begins, I think many of you will know it, "Say not the struggle naught availeth." I understand that Winston Churchill, one of the greatest parliamentarians the world has known, used this poem himself as a plea for the United States of America to step in against Nazi Germany. Today, I want to make a rather different point that we can work together, combining political wisdom from East and West to bring the light of democratic values to all peoples in Burma and beyond. I will just read the final verse. I was advised that the whole poem was far too long. And not by eastern windows only, when daylight comes in the light. In front, the sun climbs slow, how slowly, but westward, look, the land is bright. I would like to emphasize in conclusion that this is the most important time for Burma, that this is the moment of our greatest need, and so I would ask that our friends, both here in Britain and beyond, participate and support Burma's efforts towards the establishment of a truly democratic and just society. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to address the members of one of the oldest democratic institutions in the world. Thank you for letting me into your midst. My country has not yet entered the ranks of truly democratic societies, but I am confident that we will get there before too long, with your help. Thank you.
Aung San Suu Kyi, on behalf of the House of Lords and everyone here today, may I express our collective and heartfelt thanks for your inspiring words. We all espouse freedom and democracy, but few of us are called upon to pay for and uphold these principles by spending 15 years in detention. Your presence here today is a testament to your courageous approach of steadfast non-violence and reason in the face of an oppressive, powerful, and determined regime. Your struggle has reverberated around the world. It has forcibly reminded us that free and fair elections, a free press, an independent judiciary, and the institutions of civil society are the cornerstones of democracy and individual freedom. We take these freedoms for granted at our peril. Democracy is never won once and forever. It is a process requiring constant vigilance. Today, you've reminded us of the struggle that must continue in Burma and elsewhere. In post-war Europe, we have seen that it is possible for countries to make the transition from totalitarianism to democracy, and I trust that this will give you hope and encouragement for the journey ahead. Your stand against repression has been at the heart of the National League for Democracy's struggle. I'm sure that at times during your long campaign, you must have felt unbearably lonely, though as you yourself have said, the Nobel Peace Prize allowed you to feel part of the international community. And indeed, through you, your people and your country were always in our minds. Now, together, we must use this occasion of your address to fellow parliamentarians to renew our own determination to be part of the struggle for liberty, whenever and wherever it arises. Thank you.